Hello students, so to sum up what I taught in the last class about carcinoma of the colon, that carcinoma of the colon involves male and female equally, and the risk factors which I have told you was that most of the colonic carcinoma occurs sporadically, that is we don't know the rhymes and reasons of why it occurs. And just 20-25% has a genetic cause of it, okay? And of all the causes, important causes are adenoma. As I told you in the last class, adenoma are of various, there are polyps in the colon, which can be adenomatous polyp, which are tubular, tubulovillous and villous. There are polyps because of inflammation, we call it inflammatory polyp or pseudopolyps. They have almost very, very low risk of malignancy. Then we have hyperplastic or metaplastic polyps. They're usually small polyps in the colon. They also have negligible risk of malignancy. We have hamartomatous polyp and juvenile polyp. But here we are concerned about adenomatous polyp, which are of tubular, tubulovillous and villous type. See, the size of the polyp is very important. If it is 1 centimeter or more, there is 10% chance of it being malignant or having dysplasia. If it is more than 3 centimeter, there is 35-40% of chances that it might be malignant. Okay, and villous adenoma are more likely to be malignant as compared to tubular and tubulovillous. So most of these colonic carcinoma, they start as an adenoma and then change to carcinoma. This we call adenoma carcinoma sequence. Okay, this is very important cause of carcinoma colon, those with adenomas. Okay. Other causes I told you, FAP, familial adenomatous polyposis coli, where mutation in the APC gene occur. Then we have told you HNPCC, where there is mutation in the DNA mismatch repair genes. This increases the risk of colorectal carcinoma, and also mutation in the KRAS and P53 genes. I also told you about various dietary and environmental factors. How important is if somebody takes high red meat, saturated fat, smokes or takes alcohol, then they are at increased risk of getting colorectal carcinoma. Okay, low dietary fiber also is an increased risk factor. If you don't have fiber, too much of fiber, then what happens that the transit time of the feces increases. So the carcinogen has got increased exposure to the mucosa. Okay, that's why if you have lot of fiber, then the carcinogens have got less time to be exposed to the mucosa, and so less likely to become malignant. So these are the factors which increases the risk of course, inflammatory bowel disease, especially ulcerative colitis, long standing more than 10 years, increases the risk of colorectal carcinoma. And marginally, cholecystectomy also increases the risk of colonic carcinoma, especially on the right side. This we have discussed. I also told you about the clinical features, that most of these patients, if they have lesion on the right side, they present to you with an occult bleeding. Okay, and occult bleeding leads to iron deficiency anemia. They can also have abdominal pain. Okay, abdominal pain and change in bowel habit, weakness, weight loss and all. The left-sided lesions, I told you, will produce pain mostly in the suprapubic region, and they can lead to bleeding per rectum, change in bowel habit, especially the left-sided lesion usually produces constipation, and sigmoid colon is the narrowest part, so it can lead to intestinal obstruction, and can patient can present to you with large bowel obstruction. Okay, so these we have discussed. Then I told you about staging, Duke's staging and TNM staging. Okay, always remember Duke staging limited to rectal wall, that is within the fascia propria. Beyond fascia propria, beyond muscularis propria, but no lymph node involvement. C with lymph node involvement, no matter where in the rectal wall, if lymph node is positive, it's C. Okay, similarly T NM classification I have discussed. Now coming to the investigation, I have told you the most important investigation in these cases is, as always, you take a detailed history of the patient, specifically asking for bleeding, changing bowel habit, pain and TC, and you do and also family history of any colorectal carcinoma. Then you do a detailed examination of the patient, general examination, especially look for pallor, lymphadenopathy, isn't it? And abdominal examination, look for any hepatomegaly, where heart, nodular, liver, suggestive of meds is there, or cytic fluid is there in the peritoneum cavity, or any lump in the abdomen is there. Do a DRE, where you can see if there is a rectal tumor. Higher up colonic carcinoma, of course, you will not feel by DRE. For that, you have to do flexible sigmoidoscopy and full colonoscopy. Okay, full colonoscopy has advantage that it will see the whole colon. It will tell you if there is another polyp somewhere in the colon, if there is second malignancy in the colon, and you can also take biopsies from them. Okay, and you confirm the diagnosis. Other tests I told you, you can do a CECT abdomen and chest to see if where the growth is limited or it has extended to other parts of the abdominal cavity, like it has spread to liver and it has got ascites and carcinoma peritonei or got mets to the chest. Okay, so you have to do, because you know, as I told you, in carcinoma rectum also, the carcinoma colon can spread by lymphatic spread. And I told you lymphatics, the right side, they accompany the vessel and will go eventually to the superior mesenteric and then pararetic. From the left side, inferior mesenteric and then the pararetic. So, and it can spread by hematogenous route. I told you, most of the large gut drain by portal vein into the liver. So the first place where you look for meds by hematogenous route is liver. It produces liver meds. Okay. It also spreads by transilomically, means inside abdominal cavity. It can spread and involve adjacent organ. Your adjacent organ, see on the right side, what is there posteriorly? You have ureter, gonadal vessels, isn't it? And so these can be involved. On the left side also you have your left ureter, gonadal vessels, these can be involved easily. And adjacent organs can be involved. So you have to look for these also, okay? So it can spread lymphatic, hematogenous, transilamic, and it can spread by contiguous spread. Means it has involved mucosa, submucosa, muscle, then beyond, and then involving adjacent organs. So these are the way it spreads. So you have to look for meds there on at these places. Then you have other investigation like virtual colonoscopy, where bowel is prepared and with the help of CECT and contrast enhanced CT, you can take the whole picture of colon like in colonoscopy. This is called virtual colonoscopy. It is done with the help of CT scan. Though the limitation is you cannot take biopsy from it. You have to go for real colonoscopy for biopsy anyway, isn't it? PET CT can be done to look for meds in the tumor. Okay. And I told you tumor marker CEA is important. Very high level suggests poor prognosis. And if CEA level comes down to normal, it's a good thing after surgery, and then it rises again, then you know that patient has got recurrence of colorectal carcinoma. So now coming to the treatment part, okay? So how do you treat colorectal carcinoma? For treating, obviously, first you have to stage the disease, in which stage it is in early, locally advanced or advanced cases, okay? And of course you have to test for the fitness for surgery and anesthesia of the patient. Do all the blood tests and all. Okay. If it is operable, that is, it is limited to the colonic wall and to the nodes only, you do an operative resection. The principle of resection is that suppose the lesion is in the cecum or ascending colon, okay, then the treatment is right hemicolectomy. This is the lesion in the cecum. If lesion is here in the ascending colon, then also the treatment is the same. What is the principle? We take about 10 to 15 centimeter of the ileum. We take cecum, ascending colon, hepatic flexor, and the proximal third of transverse colon. We ligate ileocolic vessel on the superior mesenteric, we ligate middle colic on the superior mesenteric, and we ligate the right branch of the middle colic. Okay, right colic and right branch of the middle colic, and also take the mesentery, that is mesocolon, containing the lymph node. So you resect the 10 cm of the ileum, cecum, ascending colon, hepatic flexor, proximal transverse colon, together with the mesentery and the lymph node. And then ileum is anastomosed to the transverse colon to restore the continuity. This is the right hemicolectomy. This is the treatment of choice for lesion in the cecum, ascending colon. If lesion is higher up in the hepatic flexor, all you have to do is extend, which we call it extended right hemicolectomy. In this, what we will do, you will ligate the middle colic at its base. If lesion is in the proximal third of the transverse colon, you can do the same, extended right hemicolectomy. All you have to do is ileocolic, right colic, as well as middle colic you have to tie and remove the 10 cm of ileum, cecum, ascending colon, hepatic flexor, and the proximal third and or proximal half, depending upon where the lesion is of the transverse colon, and restore the GI continuity with ileotransverse anastomosis. Okay, suppose the tumor is there in the splenic flexor. If tumor is there at the splenic flexor, then again you can do an extended right hemi, that is 10 cm of ileum, cecum, ascending colon, hepatic flexor, whole of transverse colon, and 5 cm till descending colon, 5 cm distal to the tumor. This is extended right hemicolectomy, and then you do take all the mesentery and lymph nodes and do an ileo descending anastomosis. Or some surgeons prefer to do, for splenic flexor and descending colon growth, left hemicolectomy. Okay, left hemicolectomy, we ligate the inferior mesenteric artery, at its base. Okay, so here the left branch of middle colic is ligated, and left colic is ligated. Okay, a few of the sigmoid, one or two sigmoidal can be ligated, and you excise all this part with, together with the mesentery and lymph nodes, and you can do colocolic anastomosis. This is left hemicolectomy for the tumor on the left side of the colon. Okay, and further down, I have told you in carcinoma rectum, in upper and middle third, you can do anterior resection, where you resect the tumor 5 cm above and below with mesocolon, with mesentery and the lymph node, and do end-to-end anastomosis. Or below, if it lower third, if it is involving a sphincter, you do abdominoperineal resection. That is, you remove whole of the rectum with the sphincteric complex and the whole of the anal canal with the sphincteric complex in the rectum, together with mesentery and the lymph node, and a permanent end sigmoid colostomy is prepared. So this is how, tumor on the right side, you do right hemicolectomy, on the left side, you do left hemicolectomy. Okay, if tumor has got, if lymph node involvement is there, then we adjuvant chemotherapy is given. That is, after the operation, we give chemotherapy, 5-fluorouracil especially, oxaliplatinum and leucovorin. That is called FOLFOX regimen, is given as an adjuvant, that is after surgery. Okay, suppose the patient, has got mets in the liver. If there is solitary mets or two mets localized on one side of the lobe these days, that is excised as well, which is called metastasectomy. That is, the mets is removed. But suppose if there is multiple mets on both the liver, then you can't remove it. Okay. Other thing is, suppose if patient is presenting to you with obstruction as an emergency, large bowel obstruction, then what do we do? If the growth is on the right side, then we do a right hemicolectomy, and most of the time you can do a permanent end ileostomy, and you can do an end ileostomy temporarily, and once condition improves, you can anastomose.